Welcome to the 27th meeting of 2015. Everyone present is asked to switch off mobile phones and other electronic devices as they interfere with the broadcasting system. Some committee members will consult tablets during the course of the meeting as we provide papers in digital format. No apologies have been received today, and we move on to our first item of business, which is to take evidence on the Footway Parking and Double Parking Scotland Bill. We have two panels giving evidence. The first is from the perspective of pavement and road users, and the second from the perspective of the local authorities and Police Scotland, who will be responsible for implementing and enforcing the bill. For the first panel, I introduce Jane Horsburgh from Guide Dogs Scotland, Stuart Hay from Living Streets Scotland, Chris Campbell from the Road Haulage Association, Morven Brooks from the Scottish Disability Equality Forum, John Binning from Strathclyde Partnership for Transport, and David Livey from Sustrans Scotland. George, I believe you have something at this point.
I say that I'm a patron of the Scottish Disability Equality Forum, so just so you're aware of that before I say anything.
Thank you. Does anyone want to make any brief, and I mean brief, opening statements? Wait, Mr. Hay?
I'd just like to welcome the fact that the committee has chosen to take evidence on this issue. It's a big issue for all the charities that are represented here in terms of our mailbag. And I think there's a fundamental principle about how we use our streets and what our pavements are for in terms of providing safe passage for pedestrians, and particularly for vulnerable pedestrians. And I think the principles of what we're talking about here are sound, and it's about how you work on a practical basis on how we manage our streets. And the final point really is that the existing law, from our perspective, just isn't working. A lot of people will contact us but out of sheer frustration because they can't get the councils or the police to do anything about this. And this is sort of vulnerable people. In some cases, they can't get their house, can't go down to the shops, can't do the things that they want to do. So we do need to look at this issue. So I think this is a really welcome step that the Scottish Parliament's taken.
Anyone else? Mr. Livey, please.
Sustrans Scotland as well supports this bill, the general principles of it. Inconsiderate parking is an issue for pedestrians and for cyclists alike. Stuart's obviously touched on how it affects pedestrians in particular, so I'll focus on how it affects cyclists. In particular, parking in front of drop kerbs and double parking are a big issue for those who choose to make journeys by bike. Not only does it create an inconvenience, also creates a hazard for those who choose to make journeys by bike. I think that this bill will support Scottish Government policy on active travel. So there's a generally positive policy landscape on active travel, things like the Cycling Action Plan for Scotland, the National Walking Strategy. These policies seek to make it safer and more attractive for people to make everyday journeys by foot and bike, and I think this bill in general supports this policy landscape.
Ms. Horsburgh, please.
Thank you, Jane Horsburgh from Guide of Scotland. This, in the surveys that we've actually done, this has been the most sort of obstacle actually on pavements that people are coming up against, and we can provide people with guide dogs, we can provide people with other forms of mobility. We also have a charity called Blind Children UK that actually works with children and young folk to help mobility and independence, but it's actually getting out in our streets and onto transport. If you can't actually access your streets well, then you can't really join up and take part in your communities and go about your daily business. This is one of the biggest issues that we are actually dealing with just now, and it seems to be growing, the problem of particularly of parking on pavements and over drop kerbs. So I really welcome the fact we're actually looking at it, and hopefully we can take it forward quite positively.
Thank you. Anyone else? Mr. Binning, please.
Thank you. John Binning from SPT. SPT would support the principles of the bill, and we would acknowledge the difficulties that inconsiderate parking can cause, and I would echo a number of the comments we've made so far. We have a concern, however, that an unintended consequence of the bill could be that it would be more difficult for buses to navigate their way through narrow roads. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms Brooks, please.
Scottish Disability Equality Forum and our members greatly welcome this bill. There is a widespread problem for disabled people in using pavements and drivers blocking dropped kerbs. It does have a fundamental impact on disabled people's health, and especially their health and wellbeing and safety as well. So again, I'd just like to reiterate that we do welcome this along with our members.
Thank you. Mr Campbell, do you want to say anything at this point?
No, I'm quite happy to sit still and quiet, please.
Okay, glad. There's been an argument from some that existing legislation could be used to deal with these difficulties. I have to say, from my own perspective and dealing with things over many years as a councillor and now as an MSP, trying to use existing legislation to deal with some of the footway parking issues has been extremely difficult indeed. Can you maybe give us an indication of what you think of existing legislation, and do you think that that's adequate to deal with some of the problems that this draft bill is hoping to address? Who wants to take that on? Mr Hay?
Yeah, thank you. I think it's interesting in Scotland that it is illegal to drive on pavements, but you can park on a pavement, and that is virtually unenforceable. There's very few examples. The police do have powers, but it's very difficult for them to use these powers. So we welcome the fact that the police have actually looked at this bill and see this as a useful set of tools that they can use. There is powers that local authorities could use, but none of them have chosen to do so. And I think that's proof in itself. If the powers are available, local authorities do know what they are. There was a memo went from the Scottish Government to all the local authorities in the last 3 or 4 years that says these are the powers you could use to tackle this issue, but they're obviously not practical. This is a much simpler and more consistent approach.
You've talked about the existing legislation which doesn't allow folk to drive on pavements. One of the arguments that I've had previously is in order to park on the pavement, you've got to drive on the pavement to get the car on. I don't know if you tried that argument before in terms of some of the issues that you've tried to resolve, and where did you get with that?
That argument has been made, but it just doesn't work because the police aren't in a position to enforce. It comes down to whether they can what constitutes an obstruction, and proving that is very difficult. And it's the police, the police have got a lot of pressures on them, and they need simple, effective legislation that allows them to identify a problem. And this really should sit with other truck parking offences and be decriminalised as a fixed penalty notice type of offence.
Okay, Mr Campbell, please.
That's a question I have, actually, and it relates to the fact that the existing legislation allowing certain vehicles to load and unload on pavements when necessary may not be included in this bill. And we respectfully request that the facilities under Section 19 of the Road Traffic Act 1988, I think it is, are still available. And there seems to be no mention of that in Section 1 of the proposed bill.
Okay, that's maybe something that the committee will choose to ask the mover of the bill, Sandra White, when she appears in front of us next week, and we also have the opportunity to speak to government ministers next week and may raise that issue. Mr Livey, please.
So just to touch on, again, drop kerbs and double parking. So drop kerbs provide safe access point for people who are travelling by bike between cycle tracks and carriageways. At present, my understanding certainly is that local authorities can't take action on drop kerbs from being parked on, unlike in some local authorities in England. So under the Traffic Management Act 2004 in England and Wales, in special enforcement zones, local authorities can take action on drop kerbs. That's not the case in Scotland at present. My understanding is that a traffic regulation order, a TRO, has to be put in place for every drop kerb. So the legislation, the bill would prohibit parking at drop cairns with and tidy that up rather than a local authority having to put in a TRO for every drop kerb. On double parking can force people who are travelling by bike further into the carriageway and sometimes into the other side of the road. So this obviously creates not just an inconvenience but hazard as well. So my understanding is at present, and this is based on the evidence given by Police Scotland, is that the powers to deal with these offences have to constitute an obstruction, but what constitutes an obstruction is not clear. So this bill obviously makes it quite clear that double parking is a vehicle parked more than 50 centimetres from the edge of a carriageway, so that makes it quite specific and would make it easier to enforce. And obviously at present, the powers to deal with an obstruction don't extend to local authorities. This bill would extend it to local authorities.
Does anyone else want to come? Ms Horsburgh.
I think if the legislation was working, we wouldn't have the issue that is hitting all our post boxes just now. I think, you know, for somebody to actually report, I don't think it's going to be a priority for people. They're going to come up against an obstacle, you report it to the police, you then have to wait for the police to come, and then they've got to make an opinion whether it is or not an obstruction. It's quite a difficult thing to do, and it's not something that most people probably would be willing to do. But I want to focus on the fact that there is no definition of what an obstruction actually is. It's left very vague, and it's left up to the opinion of that reporting, responding officer. So we've talked about it gives a clearer, the definition gives clearer for enforcement. I think it also just gives clearer to society that you can't do something. You know, it is actually an obstruction, and it's almost part of the education that would be required, because I think sometimes people don't realise the impact of parking over a drop kerb or parking on a pavement. So it does sort of give a clear statement as well as helpful for the actual enforcement then to occur. And Police Scotland, we welcome the fact that this is what they've said. It strengthens the weaknesses that are actually in the current piecemeal legislation.
Thank you. The draft bill, as it stands, would omit A and B roads and private roads from this. What are your views on that? Do you think that A and B roads and private roads should be included in this legislation? Any comment on that? Mr. Hay?
I think that would be useful. It's probably a small number of more likely rural settlements that have those roads running through them where this will be an issue. So it does tie, as I understand it, the bill as drafted focuses pretty much on urban areas, and that's defined by the presence of street lighting. So this is a slight anomaly that would be useful to tidy up.
Anyone else have comment on that?
Well, can I
Mr. Campbell?
Thank you. I understand fully the standard of the bill and what it's trying to achieve in terms of objectives, but as far as the road freight logistics sector is concerned, our job is to deliver the goods, whether we like it or not. Yes, we must comply with the regulations, and any further regulations which make life more difficult and more expensive for us to carry out our work, we're not going to be in favour for. Now, if we can prove that our sector is causing all of these problems with drop parking, double parking on kerbs in towns and villages and through all the A and B routes, then fair enough. But apart from that, I would suggest that it be maintained to the urban areas and towns and cities.
I don't think anybody is accusing the road haulage industry of causing all of the problems in this regard, Mr. Campbell. I think that this goes much, much, much beyond the road haulage industry. Mr. Wilson.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. It's just on the drop kerb issue. Now, there's, I know Living Streets have made a comment regarding the exemption for residential drop kerbs compared to designated drop kerbs. Should we have designated drop kerbs? Because in streetscaping, a lot of local authorities have actually put in town centres drop curbs for wheelchair users and mobility scooter users to be able to go across the road, get on the other side of the road with safety. But clearly there may be issues if you try to enforce a prohibition on drop curbs outside residential properties, particularly where residents have actually put in off-street parking outside their house and they've actually paid for the drop curb to be put in there to allow them to get access to the parking in front of their house. So how do we define what is a drop curb and what drop curbs should be exempt from potential legislation in this matter?
Who's going to take that off, first of all? Mr.
Hay? I think that there is more work needed on this point in the bill, and from a Living Streets perspective and this perspective of colleagues and other charities, it is really about defined drop curbs that have been put in place by councils to help people cross the road, and they're designed. The council should know where they are at present. Some of them will already be lined, but this would protect all of them automatically. And it's quite obvious that these come in pairs on either side of the road, which is different from a residential. A resident, what we'd across a crossover, I think you would call it, where you can cross the pavement to enter a driveway. So I think there's two issues there, and our focus is obviously on the ones that are there for people with mobility issues.
Anyone else want to come in on that one, Mr. Campbell? Please.
Yes, I'm here again. Absolutely agree there. I do notice that, or we do notice in the section two, that the drop curb facility would apply no longer than necessary and for no more than 20 minutes. Now, if this is contained in the bill, that would give our sector some problems, because it can take longer than 20 minutes to, for example, house removal, or indeed now with internet shopping, not only does the lorry driver come along and deliver your television or your fridge, he's got to go into your house and connect it up, and that probably would be more than 20 minutes. So we would be concerned on the 20-minute limit.
Ms. Briggs, please.
Concern from our members who are disabled people across Scotland, if the enforcement, especially in drop curbs, it doesn't take place or doesn't get passed, it affects disabled people's lives on a daily basis. They have to think about, when they first leave their home in the morning, how they're going to reach their destination. Because if they know that there's an area which is well known for people either double parking or parking over a drop curb, then it's obstructing their onward journey. And likewise, when they actually get to their destination and backwards, they have to think again. It affects their health, their stress levels will rise because they have to take a diversion of their onward journey. It has a fundamental impact in every way in a disabled person's life if they have mobility, mobility problems.
And could you give us an indication of if these kind of situations affect wheelchair users only, or is it folks with other disabilities too who are not necessarily wheelchair bound?
No, not necessarily wheelchair users. It could be mobility scooters. It could be anybody with a walking aid who obviously struggle walking long distances. But it could even be a short distance that's still being obstructed for them because of the selfish act of parking over a drop curb or double parking and obstructing their way.
Anybody else want to come in on this one? Ms. Horsburgh, please.
Thank you. I just like to echo what Stuart said. This is about accessibility, and that is our focus. Answering people that use drop curbs or where the road has been raised up to meet the pavement to create that sort of level area to make a technical crossing point. It's not just used by people in wheelchairs or mobility scooters. They tend to be in desired walking lines, so if you're actually walking along the pavement, you're liable just to come across one. So folk that can't see it are also going to be using them. And in theory, you would think that they should be clear on each side. Now, if you can't actually see and you use one of these, you're actually walking straight across the road and you don't know if there's a vehicle, a small vehicle, let alone something larger, parked on the other side. And if that's the case, then you're actually walking up the road, feeling along the vehicles, trying to find a safe place back onto the pavement. So really, if somebody feels that they are required as a last resort to park over a drop curb or one of these sort of technical crossing points, we would hope it would be for the minimum amount of time possible. And if that means that person stopping after they've done offloading and take that vehicle somewhere else to go back, so be it. It is actually about accessibility. I personally know somebody who was stuck for 3/4 of an hour blocked in by a white van, sorry about the colour, white van stuck on a pavement and somebody over a drop curb where they had an alternative route to go home. It was four times as long, but it was an alternative route. But they couldn't do that because it was blocked either end.
Mr. Binning, are you wanting to come in there?
Yes, I think it should also be noted that drop curbs are useful for people with children in buggies and pushchairs. There are occasions as well on cycle paths where having drop curbs or even level areas onto roadways allow cyclists to safely cross the roadway as well. So I think it's worth just adding those as well.
Okay, John.
Thank you, Convener. And thank you for the clarification, because I'm just trying to make the distinction between, and I think Ms. Horsburgh described it as a technical crossing point compared to a lowered curb where no resident has actually lowered that curb. One of the issues that's come up in some of the evidence is, and somebody mentioned where the dropped curbs, the designated or technical crossing point, has not been lined and has not been identified by the local authority. And I know that in the area where I live, the local authority spent lots of money streetscaping, putting drop curbs, but there is no signage to actually say to car users that this is a technical crossing point. And the argument is that the cost to local authorities to put the signage up, to mark the roads, may be prohibitive, particularly part of the argument is in times of austerity, and also the local authorities are being asked to declutter the streetscape in terms of road signage. How do we get around the issue of designating technical crossing points and getting local authorities to clearly identify that so that motor vehicle users, whether lorry users, are aware that that is a designated crossing point for users of pavements?
Mr. Hay.
This is an important part of the bill in terms of coming to some common definitions of these types of pieces of infrastructure. And then there's a lot of education that goes before for here, and so that the motorists actually understand what these crossing points are and who benefits from them. I think if a lot of people understand that, they'll be less likely to actually park across them. So the bill is really a bridge to start educating people. The enforcement comes way down the line. The bill as drafted means that automatically all these points are protected, and then you wouldn't need to sign in line each one individually, which I think is the problem at the moment, and that's why the bill looks at a universal approach across Scotland, so it's consistent, so you can do that education. Whereas if you leave it down to individual local authorities, it becomes a bit of a hodgepodge. It becomes much more challenging. You've got to issue all these individual traffic regulation orders, whereas with the footway parking, you're only looking at a reasonably small number of exempt streets. So the local authorities actually have to do less work on this, but they will have to take on some extra duties initially to identify these streets where parking might be permissible, where you're not going to damage the pavement, where the width of the pavement is of a sensible nature that people can get by, or there actually is no viable alternative. It might be a back lane or something like that, where it's just not really sensible to ban parking on a pavement. So there will be a bit of work for the local authorities to do initially, but once that's done, the law is clear and everybody knows where they stand.
Okay, anyone else on that one? Mr. Livey.
Just to pick up on what Mr. Hay was saying there, we are, as an organisation, generally supportive of the exemptions, but in order to get that consistency across Scotland, across different local authorities, to tie in with emergency services and other interested parties, I think it would be useful to have national guidance to be provided so that the overall objectives of the bill aren't undermined.
John?
Just to respond to Mr. Hay's answer, I welcome the initiative to try and get, and I think you said, consistent across Scotland. At the present moment, we know enforcement isn't consistent across Scotland. We have some local authorities where there is no traffic wardens, so there is no monitoring of parking, street parking. In other areas, we've heard complaints that the police don't enforce the legislation that's currently in place. So how confident are the panel that if this legislation was to go through, that we would get a consistent approach throughout Scotland, particularly in areas where there is no traffic enforcement officers and local authorities, because we have 32 local authorities, all 32 have different policies regarding this. Who would enforce these restrictions and if they were introduced?
Who's going to take that on? Ms. Horsburgh. Ms. Horsburgh first, please.
I think what this bill aims to do is to provide a framework for enforcement actually to happen. So it's quite enabling that way, and it provides a framework whether it could be either police or the local authority. I think the current legislation just now, some of it lies just with the police. So this actually takes the framework forward. Local authorities make up the decisions how they want to manage the streets, and we hope that they will work with their communities through their maybe community planning sort of forums to take this forward to how they want the streets managed, to what the hot spots are, etc. But this is actually a framework that allows that discussion to happen, to go forward. So it'll be interesting to hear how some of the local authorities will be responding to some of those questions that you have there.
Okay, Mr. Campbell, please.
Thank you. Just another plug, please. What we're trying to say is that when we're operating freight logistics, we're not parking up as such. I know that sounds peculiar. We don't park, we stop to carry out an action of loading and unloading, and then we move on. It's quite simple, that, because if we're not turning the wheels, we're not earning money. So we don't want to hang about in cities and restricted areas. When it comes to enforcement of parking, that's a different matter, because if our drivers are parking up their vehicles, by mean they park up and then they go away from the lorry and maybe spend 2 or 3 hours for lunch, which I hope they're not doing, or they park up overnight, that's a different set of conditions, because under the Traffic Commissioner regulations, the lorry driver and the vehicle can be moved from a parking situation. For example, overnight, maybe parked outside somebody's house. The Traffic Commissioner has powers to move that vehicle and bring the employer to account. So there is fairly strict enforcement available for incorrect parking, long-term overnight parking, for example, with commercial vehicles bigger than the transit van size.
Some job if you get a 2 or 3 hour lunch, I have to say, Mr. Campbell. I think some of your members will be wondering what you're talking about there.
We have to meet the European complex, yeah, European okay. Drivers' hours rules.
Anyone else on that one? Mr. Binning.
Thank you. I think for those councils that have introduced decriminalised parking, this will present something of an issue in terms of stretched resources. And I think that's been acknowledged in a number of the written responses to the committee. But it's just a point I would reiterate. SPT is a partnership of 12 local authority councils in the west of Scotland, and a number of them have expressed concern about the resource issues. Inevitably, they will have priorities in terms of how an act would be enacted, and with those stretched resources, that's understandable.
How many of those 12 operate decriminalised parking at the moment?
I think the majority at the moment. I don't know the precise number, but the majority do.
Okay. Cara Hilton, please.
Thank you, convener. Can I say from the start, I am very sympathetic to this bill, but I'm just from the point of view from a road user's perspective. John Binnan earlier referred to the implications possibly for bus drivers, and Jane and Stuart talked about it being about education. And I do agree education is a factor, but the reality is that in quite a lot of new build and council estates, there's just simply no option but for residents to park on the pavement. And when I think about my constituency, there's parking on both sides, and at people, if people weren't parked on the pavement, buses simply wouldn't get down those roads. They're almost single file as it is. So I wonder what the panel think could be alternative solutions to be introduced to accommodate any displaced cars that would result from a parking ban. You know, basically, where should residents park their cars instead of parking on the pavements?
Who's going to take that on? It's a difficult one to answer. Mr. Billing, first of all, please.
I think it is a very good point. I mean, we have expressed our concern about the unintended consequences of the bill. Of course, we support the principles of the bill and we understand that the problems that inconsiderate parking can cause. But I know that there's been reference before to traffic reduction orders, etc., and that there are difficulties with those. But we would hope that within the bill there could be some discretion given to local authorities, particularly in those kind of council estates, pre-war and post-war estates, etc., that were never really intended to accommodate the level of parking that there currently is. The local authorities would continue to have some discretion in those areas because we recognise that there isn't sufficient overspill parking there and there aren't enough driveways to accommodate all the vehicles.
Mr. Hay?
Exempt certain areas, and I think hopefully that would mean a lot of these estates that the pavements can be quite wide and, they be, and the curb can be quite low, so that the resulting damage from parking on them is not going to be as big an issue. So I think that's one stage, but ultimately I think the local authorities in some areas will have to choose between the rights of people to park outside their house or the rights of a disabled person to go about their daily lives, and that's, you can't get away from that with this. There is wider questions about how we actually start looking at transport policy. We're here because basically as a country for the last 40 years we've failed to manage traffic in urban areas, and we need to start looking at that. But I don't think we can say that disabled people, visually impaired people should pay the price basically for that failure, because that's ultimately what we're saying. So, and it probably will be less, it will deal with itself in some areas that will be driven by people in those areas who have particular access. They will force the agenda on enforcement. If there's nobody being obstructed, then the pressure on the local authority to do anything in these areas will be much less. But where there is a need, there should be the ability of local authorities to deal with that need in terms of fair access to pavements.
Anyone else? Mr. Binning, you want to come back in there?
Sorry, if I could just make another point. SPT operates My Bus services, which are intended to support more vulnerable transport users who find using mainstream buses challenging. And those buses...
Other subjects, Mr. Binning, I want to stick to this bill. And while your other policies may be really exciting and interesting, I want to stick to this bill. Okay. Ms. Brooks, please.
I just wanted to follow on. Many of our members have made comments at the fact that obviously enforcement is currently difficult, and probably moving forward, if the bill gets passed, probably will still be difficult. I just wanted to highlight the fact, though, that there are 46 access panels throughout Scotland, and again, reiterating what the other panel members have said as well, the local authorities could work closer with the local communities. The access panels are an ideal route to do that. They look at accessibility issues, whether it be buildings or pavement parking, and I'm sure each local each access panel would welcome that relationship with their local authorities to move that forward.
Cara?
I still think it's a great area. I still don't think we've got an answer to where residents that are displaced would park, but obviously that's something that we'd have to consider further, I think. So.
Okay. Cameron Buchanan, please.
Thank you very much indeed, Convener. I just wanted to pick up Mr. Campbell's point about removals. I understood that local authorities can apply for a permit when a removal is taking place, therefore there would be no need for special exemption under 4 hours. Is that correct?
Mr. Campbell.
The point I think it was making is that in the bill, it doesn't say that, and technically we could end up in miles of red tape every time we do a delivery. We have to get a permit or someone to give us permission, and that would seem to be the case for parking our lorries when we have to on pavements. There is an application in section 6 that we can ask for special permission, But I mean, our vehicles are not like buses running in regular services. Our vehicles are in different places every day. It's impossible to predict the next time we do a delivery. And I gave you an example there of, if you could, can I refer to the photographic evidence, please? You'll see a vehicle there on the top left hand in picture one. Now, under the new bill, that driver has committed an offence. He has had to park on the pavement because there was a car, that black car on the corner, in the loading bay. So eventually the driver, he gets his £100 fine, and all this feeds back to the employer in terms of their operator licensing. Then the lorry goes into the loading bay, and he's committed another offence because this is an old property and the vehicle can't go back any further, so the front of the lorry is now on the kerb. So now he's now got a second offence, £100 fine, and it goes back to the traffic commissioner. Now, what you could say then is, well, we could give a permit for this, but I don't know when that lorry is going to come back. It might be next week, it might be a different supplier, it might be a different haulage contractor. So having to have a permit is just going to rapidly increase, with all due respect, red tape as far as we're concerned, and for obviously local authorities.
The point I was really making was on removals, where you said it's going to be 4 or 5 hours, and when removals take place, it's obviously in advance and people know that, and that normal local authorities apply for a permit for removals for longer than 4 or 5 hours. And surely common sense would prevail on this if he couldn't park, in your example of Warburton's there, would prevail, and therefore he wouldn't get a fine because he could say, look, I couldn't park, I had to deliver.
No,
those are available. Mr. Campbell.
Sorry for interruption. Well, I'm sorry, but the Section 1 of the proposed bill does not allow any of our vehicles to park on the kerb full stop unless there's a special written permit. Now, if that's the case, there'll be thousands of permits. Now, when it comes to the removal vehicle, the regulation still says, in the bill, or the regulation will come out as, there's a 20-minute wait if you're double parked or beside a sunken kerb. There is no right, for example, for that vehicle, and it does happen with removal vehicles, they have to get onto the kerb to let other vehicles go past. And that wouldn't be permitted either. That would be totally out with the 20-minute allowance or a permit. The permit would allow us to park for longer, but we still wouldn't be able to put that vehicle legally onto the kerb. Now, I know what you're going to say, the lorry shouldn't be on the kerb, but I'm sorry, with the design of towns, especially older towns and housing estates, we have to do that if we want to get the job done. Sorry.
Common sense that comes in here or not?
I would say there isn't too many common sense from my point of view. Because all we're going to do is say we've got a legislation that doesn't give common sense, and therefore we are technically liable. There's no confidence there that we're not going to get the bill for parking our bread van on the pavement.
Aye. But I'm going to take Mr. Hay in first, and I'll come back to you, Cameron. Mr. Hay, please.
Just a point of clarification. There's no permits in this piece of legislation. What the second part of the bill does, it provides exemptions for specific streets where there's likely to be problems. And you can see that on let's say it's a narrow shopping or high street where, yes, there will be deliveries. And the council could say that alongside other types of parking, there is some scope to park on the pavement. So there is scope in the bill there, but it's not a permit system. It's taking a street and saying, on that particular street, this is how the regulations will apply.
Thank you, Mr. Hay. Cameron, please.
Just going to ask Mr. Campbell, what would be your solution to this aspect? It's dangerous to ask that, but I want to know the answer.
It's fairly straightforward. At the moment, there is a UK Road Traffic Act, which has been on the go since I can't remember when, that allows us to park on kerbs if absolutely necessary and we won't have committed an offence. And all we're asking is, please, can we have that built into Section 1 of the bill when it comes to parking on footpaths? Bearing in mind we don't park on footpaths, we stop on them to load and unload and then move on. So the answer is quite simple. The Road Traffic Act exemptions for loading on kerbs should continue into the Scottish bill, please.
Okay, anyone else want to come in on that point before we move off? Mr. Hay, do you have anything more to add? Okay, Jane Baxter, please.
I was interested in a comment that Mr. Hay made earlier, and I was just going to reflect on, as I go about my business and visit my family and live in the world, it seems to me that in a lot of housing estates, people do park on the pavement. Now, that's goes against the principles of this bill, and I appreciate it causes real problems for anybody who's got mobility problems or is pushing a pushchair or walking along with young children. I accept that. But the reality is, for folk who live in those estates, there's a sort of mutual consent around neighbours being okay about people parking on the pavement, because most houses have got more than one car, and many houses don't have parking for more than one car. So it seems to me that if we're going to educate and encourage people to not park on the pavements, we've got to provide some other form of parking, and that takes you right back to the planning system and the consents that are given for these housing developments. Do you think that alongside this bill there would need to be changes to the planning system, or could we get round it with the sorts of local arrangements that Mr Hare referred to when he said that councils could look at neighbourhoods and work out a local arrangement?
Who's going to take that on? Ms Horsburgh first, please.
I'm glad you mentioned planning, because it was going through my mind earlier on that there is a bigger issue for the medium to long term, to actually that vehicles are accommodated where necessary in residential areas. So hopefully that would go forward. I don't know if it would sit with this, but maybe you could take some advice about what the government's viewpoint is regarding sort of planning. Certainly within their policy on designing streets, they want pedestrians and cyclists to be prioritised over vehicles, but vehicles need to be accommodated as well, a reasonable amount. So I agree that there is a sort of longer term issue, otherwise you're just building in problems for the future. But the things that have been said just now, this is not created by this bill. This has just been created by the society that we're actually in. So there's nothing new. It will actually maybe focus local authorities, it will focus more policy to actually tackle some of the areas, dare I say, that's been maybe neglected in the past. On a very practical level, it does allow local authorities through the exempt areas to actually manage the streets. Now, if you're a mum with a buggy, if you're somebody that can't actually see, if you know that one side of the street is going to be parked on, you actually then know the other side's going to be clear, you know. So it is about managing that street. We're not saying that it's easy. It's not easy, but it's worth tackling. But unless we actually sort of jump on this, we're not going to set any framework for actually tackling it. And right now, in many of these estates, we've all been in these estates, there's a whole slalom effect. And it's not feasible to have a person with a buggy slaloming from pavement to pavement and somebody that can't see coming off onto the road and having to walk straight down, feeling the way along to try and find a safe way back. That has to be a priority. But it's not easy, but it's working with the communities to do that. But there is some practical things in there that can be looked at.
Ms Brooks, please.
Just following on from what Jane was saying there, accessibility should be considered at all levels of planning. And that is the role that we take on as an organisation, a national organisation, and also the access panels. Work has to be considered within the local community, and obviously the community's needs, and especially in housing estates that you're talking about. Parking facilities are not considered, and they should be considered. But it's about equality for all. It's not just about disabled people. It's not just about, obviously, a woman with a buggy. It's about equality for all. So, again, accessibility does need to be considered at the very early planning stages.
And men with buggies as well, of course. Mr. Living.
So it's just to pick up on a point that Ms Horsburgh made. It's already actually policy that footway parking should be minimised, so that's already in designing streets, which is the policy statement for Scotland, which is published by the Scottish Government. But so going forward, basically footway parking should be designed out. That should be the policy, but we are where we are in terms of footway parking happening, and it does happen. This bill would give it legislative teeth. It would, you know, putting in place a ban would give us the ability to do something about it where it does happen at present. And it's worth bearing in mind that 30% of households in Scotland don't have access to a car. So they rely on walking, public transport, cycling. So this bill would be a huge benefit to them.
Jane?
I accept the point that Mr. Livey made. but I do know that in some areas there's 1.5 parking spaces per property. And so there is overspill parking, and that is going to have to go somewhere else, and that is going to have a knock-on effect into surrounding streets. So I think we just need to be mindful of that. But I completely accept the principle of access and mobility. That's a given. But we live in the real world, and we've got to accept that there's going to be consequences of this legislation.
Thank you. Before I take George in, can I ask if anyone has made a submission to the current planning review panel that the government has put in place on any of these issues? Mr. Livey.
Sustrans will be making a submission to that.
And any of the other organisations?
Streets plans to do so as well.
Okay. Mr. Binney.
SBT will.
Yeah. So you are being proactive in these regards as well. Yeah. George Adam, please.
On that point as well that you're speaking of there, one of the issues that you brought up, Morven, was the fact that the access panels, because one of the problems with the drop curbs is the fact it's pretty much a hodgepodge in local authorities. Some are very good, some aren't great. One might have one at one end of the street and the same one in the roads at the other end of the street. Is that not an argument for talk about putting submissions to the planning regulations that maybe access panels are looked at as a statutory organisation? Because I've found that it depends on the access panel and the local authority actually working with them, because the guys that are involved in this, they're obviously the ones that are wheelchair users. In some cases, they are people who have got visual impairments as well. And if you get them to do an audit of your town centre, then there's a good chance that you'll sort a lot of these problems out, which helps just about everybody who's given evidence here today. You know, is it not the case that we should maybe be looking at that as a way forward? Because I found I used to obviously be Renfrewshire Council's representative in the Renfrewshire one, and what a difference we made when we started doing work and not just moaning about things. And I think it's about being more proactive from that perspective.
Ms. Brooks.
Absolutely. That's one thing that we are working on at the moment, is looking for every access panel to become a statutory consultee. It's given them the recognition within their local authorities to provide the advice and the recommendations that's needed within initial planning stages, of whether it be a building or whether it be parking. Absolutely, I fully agree with you there. Yeah.
This situation with Renfrewshire Access Panel, where they had an accessible toilet that was fully accessible, apart from it was the wrong side of the building and nobody could actually get into it. So they obviously didn't speak to the access panel at that stage. So it's one of these things that if we do get it at an early stage at planning, we can make that difference.
Mr. Hay, please.
I think there is a challenge here. I'm going to be optimistic and say that the Scottish Government has good policies on transport, and we're going to try and reduce car use over time. So we're at a difficult point here. We're at the most difficult point. But we are trying to get more people walking and cycling. There's policies in place for that. We are trying to get people on public transport and their support for things like car clubs. And that's going to take a good amount of time, but it will improve neighbourhoods more generally. So we should say there is a problem today, but there's a lot of other solutions as well about how we manage our neighbourhoods that are available to us if we're bold enough in terms of helping people meet their mobility needs in a different way.
Okay, anyone else on this? No. George?
No.
Okay, thank you. Willie Coffey, please.
We certainly do seem to live in a society where town centres, streetscapes, and estates are designed more for people with cars and to allow people to get around. I mean, you can just see the difficulty that people do have and the ease with which people with cars seem to get around towns and delivery vehicles too. So I'm very sympathetic to the aims of the bill and the suggestions that people have offered today to the committee. But where I would be concerned, though, is in cases where there isn't congestion. All the examples today I've been thinking about situations where there's congestion and people do find it difficult to move around. But imagine the other side of this, where there isn't any congestion. Like, I know some housing estates where there are hardly any cars, and this bill would create an offence if a van turned up to deliver a telly when there's no problem being created. So could I have the panel's views on that side of it? Are there consequential effects of the bill that would create an offence where really there's no problems being you know, evident by people delivering goods and so on to people's houses where there aren't any examples of congestion. Are we inevitably heading towards a set of compromises here? Exemptions and discretions and so on and so forth? Or do we need loading, unloading exemptions that Mr. Campbell mentioned? I'd certainly like to move it forward and improve the situation, but I wouldn't like to see us creating anomalies and further problems because of it.
Mr. Campbell first, please.
Thank you very much. I agree entirely, and sorry to repeat myself, but we're happy with sections 2 and 3 of the bill, double parking and the drop curbs, not a problem. And all we're saying is, at the moment, we've got in the Highway Code, it points out in the legislation that says that if necessary, we need to do certain things which probably aren't going to make people too happy, but we do have a job to do, and that's deliver the goods. So there are occasions when we will be a bit longer, we might have to go into the curb. And I gave you an example there with the bread lorry. He's just trying to make a delivery. He's already committed 2 offences under the proposed regulations.
Mr. Campbell, because the photo is not particularly great from my perspective anyway. It's maybe because I'm not particularly good at looking at darker things. But, you know, one of the things which has been highlighted by folks before is that delivery drivers seem to think that they have a divine right to park right in front of the building that they're delivering to, rather than offloading a little bit away and maybe taking the pallets or cages or whatever it is a little bit further along. Would you like to comment on that?
Well, no doubt that does happen, because it's all human nature. If those matters are continuing, then we would need to know about it, and we can take action within our own systems. But the driver...
So what action could you take to stop one of your members from maybe blocking a road, a pavement in an area which is causing some grief?
Well, if it was a continuing problem, then their membership, if they were members, and in this particular case, this company isn't a member of ours, and that's why we took the photograph, then we could expel them from membership. But the catch-out system is the traffic commissioner. And the traffic commissioner is in charge of all, if you like, heavy goods vehicle operations in the UK, and in Scotland we have a Scottish traffic commissioner. And regularly, companies will get called to account to public inquiry in matters of safety and danger. So if a company was proved to be maybe causing danger in their loading procedures, then they could end up in front of the traffic commission, possibly lose their licence to run their vehicles.
And how many times has that happened in, say, the past year?
Well, that's the point I'm making. We don't seem to have any complaints about lorries parking on the kerbs. And if they are, they're not bringing to our attention.
Anyone else on Mr. Coffey's point? Ms. Brooks.
I just wanted to touch on the fact that the majority of our members don't actually... they're not against the exemption of lorries parking for a short period to get on with their job. They realise that day-to-day activities have to happen. But one of the comments that have been made, make sure certain provisions should be put in place. So the driver should be available to move the vehicle if to allow a disabled person with a mobility problem to continue their journey. Many times comments have been made that the driver's not available or won't move the vehicle. So there's attitude problems as well. It's not just, obviously, legislative. There's attitude problems that obviously need to be educated underneath this as well. But certain provisions put in place that could obviously work.
Ms. Horsburgh, do you want to come in there?
Yes, a little bit. For somebody that can't see, I mean, the chances are, either, if they can't see at all, the chances are they're just going to hit the lorry. they're going to come in contact with the lorry or come in contact with the wing mirror. But I can't think of a time where somebody's moved their lorry. But obviously, the larger vehicle, the more, and I have to say the word dangerous it actually is. But I've not come across a time where folk are willing to move. They tend to be asked to wait.
On Willie's point, I think in terms of an estate, an area where, you know, there's not really a problem, but a lorry parks up on the curb,
and there's someone in that area with a visual impairment, does that actually make the situation more dangerous for that person with a visual impairment because they're not used to that happening in the area?
You've answered your own question. It's the unexpected obstacles. If you know that your street is full of parked vehicles, then it doesn't make it better, but you know that they're there, you know. But coming up against an unexpected obstacle, then yes, that actually does make it worse. But if there's no congestion, I would have to query why they're maybe parking on the pavement. Do you know, if there's no congestion, maybe they could park slightly further away. Sorry, it's just a practical thing.
Willie?
No, I'm just thinking, I do know estates in my own constituency where there's no cars. There's no cars in the street. So along comes Mr Campbell's van with the telly on it and they can't park there. Or load or unload. Is that what we're saying we want? Do we recognise that that's an issue? Certainly when it's congestion and town centres are crammed full and all this, these problems are recreated, absolutely we have to do something about it. But does the bill create that anomaly? Where there's no problem being manifest, we're creating an offence?
My understanding is no, but is there any... Ms Brooks?
It's earlier again, it's about quality for everybody. Anybody could move into that street, that new town, and be new to the area and have a disability and then be affected. So you can't assume that because there's no current problems that there will be no problems in the future. So we have to think about making a society that's equal for everybody.
Ms Horsburgh, do you want to come back in again there? And no, maybe I'm misreading your signals.
Yeah, I think you're misreading my signals, actually. I can talk, though. Yeah.
On you go if you want to.
No, you're
OK. Willie? OK, thank you very much. Mr Hay, sorry.
I think we're looking at areas where there's a particular problem, and that's where the enforcement will be. The enforcement resources, as has been said, is very limited. You're not going to go to these estates. It's really a tool that will be concentrated where there's real problems, and it's probably also outside a lot of the existing controlled parking zones because there's already enforcement there and people generally will behave themselves and there's probably yellow lines down. So we're looking at a particular set of circumstances here, but it does send a signal to people that if you can avoid it, don't park on the pavement, where people at the moment see it's an easy option, I'll just bounce up on the pavement. And the big issue with that actually is pavements are not designed for vehicles. So in that state, you're running large vehicles over a pavement, bouncing them up the kerb, you're damaging those pavements, they're then becoming trip hazards, which is another problem for groups. So there's another objective behind this bill, and that is to protect the actual infrastructure we've got. Unless we start designing pavements to be parked on, which is going to be very, very expensive, we need to do what's in this bill.
Mr Livey?
It's just to draw the committee's attention to Police Scotland's evidence, which basically reiterates what Mr Hayes just said, and that's that the new legislation will provide the police and local authorities, where appropriate, with the necessary legislation to take action where there's a problem. And I think that's at the crux of the issue as well. And I think Cycling Scotland and their evidence as well said that it will enable local authorities and police to tackle this where there are hot spots. So basically, where there's a problem, it can be addressed.
Okay. Anyone else in that? One of the things which, and I'm going to be the devil's advocate again, one of the things is that some folk have suggested that all of this can be dealt with by common sense. But it seems that common sense has kind of gone out the window in certain places in terms of this issue, where folks are finding it difficult to navigate their neighbourhoods. What have you got to say to those folks who think that there should be no additional legislation and that common sense should apply rather than creating new laws? Ms Horsburgh.
I thought I'd put my hand up, so I misconstrued. What is common sense? I mean, it's in the eyes of whoever decides it. Can it be dealt with common sense? If it could be, I think we would be there now. I don't know what common sense sort of is, because you need some knowledge of the impact this is having, and we can't assume everybody actually understands the impact of parking at pavements and over drop curbs actually has on people. But it gets back to my So my answer is I don't think it can be dealt with through common sense. I wish it was, and I welcome the folk who apply all that appropriately. But I think it gets back to having what I always call the three E's, which is an education for people, you know, and then encouragement to do the right thing, and then enforcement. I do think you have to educate folk of the impact that it's actually having, and sort of change that attitude. And I'm under no doubt that given clarity, some attitudes will change, because it is just knowing the impact. But I do think there's a role, probably, if this goes forward, that the Scottish Government do look at a sort of education programme.
Thank you. Mr. Livey, please.
Yeah, so in terms of whether there is a problem and this can be addressed through common sense, I think the streets outside our front doors are evidence that that's not the case. My advice to people who say that is maybe go for a walk, go for a cycle, or go and get a visual impairment training from guide dogs, and you'll see that, you know, it is an issue. For cycling, this is particularly an issue because one of the biggest barriers we have to people getting on a bike and making everyday journeys by bike are safety concerns. Now, it seems like a fairly easy fix to be able to tighten up parking, in front of drop curbs, to stop double parking where it's a problem, to stop pavement parking as well. And it would seem to add a bit of coherence to what's already there. It's Scottish Government policy to enable more people to travel actively every day. This legislation would support that.
Anyone else? Mr. Hay.
In terms of it being new legislation, we do need to remember that in London, they've had this since 1974, and it operates, and local authorities have integrated it into the other traffic management. I have every confidence that Scottish local authorities would be able to do the same, and they've got a template actually to work on that's been developed up over a number of years.
Spooks, please.
Sadly, obviously, common sense. Not everybody has that common sense, but obviously, education and awareness raising around disability issues would be important taking this forward. Amongst many other things as well. And one way to do that is not just about coming up with your own promotional campaign, work with local communities, for example, access panels, to take that forward, make sure the information is accessible, inclusive for everybody, to make sure that everybody gets the message. So it's not just about putting a campaign together, it's how you put that campaign together and who you do it with.
Thank you. Mr. Billing.
I think it's just also an issue of balance. We do need to balance the needs of a range of users of pavements, of roadways, etc. And I think there is an element of common sense that has to come into the framing of legislation. I think that's been acknowledged by a number of the respondents, and there are circumstances. As I say, I've mentioned bus services. People with mobility issues also rely on bus services. And it's important that those services are able to access our public roads.
Thank you. Mr. Campbell, do you want to say anything here?
Sorry, I'm going to have to put my blinkers on here. Our concern at this stage is probably not the additional legislation, it's the lack of certain legislation disappearing from the issue, which is the, as I mentioned, is the Road Traffic Regulation Act. Apart from that, I don't think I should say any more.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I thank you all for your evidence today? I'll suspend for a few minutes for a change of witnesses. Thank you.
As I mentioned earlier, we now move on to our second panel of witnesses. Considering this time the implementation and enforcement of the bill, and I welcome Murray Hanna from Fife Council, Superintendent Fraser Candlish from Police Scotland, David Armitage from Aberdeenshire Council, and speaking on behalf of the Society of Chief Officers of Transportation in Scotland, and Donald Gibson from South Lanarkshire Council. Do you have any opening statements that you'd like to make? Brief, please. Mr Hanna, please.
Thanks, Convener. Just basically to say thank you for the opportunity to speak to your committee today in this consultation event, which indeed, of course, is a very important piece of work. Fife Council recognises the difficulties that obstructions can cause in some situations, including parking, A-boards, waste bins, etc. So we do see that there are issues that this bill is importantly trying to address. We agree with the intentions of the bill. The bill seeks to reinforce an already wide-ranging legislation in terms of Road Traffic Acts, Road Scotland Act and the Highway Code. And we are particularly pleased that the bill recognises that not all instances of footway parking can be banned or should be banned. We believe that the bill and the intentions of the bill chimes very well with the placemaking principles of designing streets and designing streets for people. However, some of the challenges, though, will come from retrofitting some of the intentions and the details of this bill and legislation and the controls that it would bring into established streets. Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else wish to make an opening statement? Mr Armitage, please.
Yes, in as much as I'm speaking for Scots, I will be emphasising things that I think would be of universal concern. So I think all councils have concern about resources at the moment, and anything that affects resources would be something that they would want very careful consideration taken on. And the other thing is, I think road and traffic legislation is a very complex framework, and we've all had past experience of trying to implement legislation that perhaps doesn't quite mean what it's intended to mean or has unintended consequences. And especially with primary legislation such as this, that does cause problems. So the main thrust of my evidence has been to point out areas where perhaps in the bill as currently drafted, there may be issues.
Mr. Gibson, do you want to add anything at this point? Superintendent? Okay. Let me start off with the question I posed at the beginning of the last panel, and that's round about current legislation. Why is it that we kind of make current legislation work in terms of dealing with some of the issues that have been highlighted to us by many, many people in terms of footway parking? Let's start with you, Superintendent, because I've had conversations over the years with a number of police officers about folk parking on pavements and making the argument that they've obviously driven onto that pavement to park there, which driving on pavements is an offence. And yet the response you get back is not much we can do about that unless we actually see it happening.
Yes, it's quite a complex issue. In the papers, there was two pieces of legislation quoted, one being the Road Scotland Act, which makes it an offence to drive on a footway, to lead a horse on a footway, and also to cycle on a footway as well. And the second piece of legislation that was quoted in the papers was the Highways Act, which is in actual fact only for England and Wales. It's not within Scotland. So in terms of driving on a footway, it is legislation that can be used, but it's quite cumbersome in that, if a vehicle's parked on the pavement, you have to identify who owns the vehicle, then you have to make a requirement on the owner to state who was driving it, then you have to make a requirement on that named person as to whether or not they drove it at the time it was parked on the footpath, and then after the circumstances would be reported to the Procurator Fiscal with regards to whether or not the defence would be taken to court. So it is quite lengthy and it is quite cumbersome, and perhaps this new piece of legislation, if it's enacted, would create a more focused means in which to enforce legislation should that be required.
Have you got any indication, Superintendent, of how many folk, say, in the past year have been done in Scotland for driving on pavements?
No, I don't have that information with me today.
Do you think it's many?
No, I don't think it's many at all.
Could it be zero?
I couldn't say with certainty, but I think the numbers would be low.
Could you provide us with that information? Because I think that would be very useful the committee. Any of the other gentlemen wish to comment on existing legislation and whether it's good enough as it stands to deal with the difficulties that have been highlighted? Mr. Gibson, please.
I think that there's quite a number of pieces of legislation that we can use. At the moment, we use traffic regulation orders. And one of the statements I think I heard you making earlier on was that local authorities don't use traffic regulation orders to prohibit footway parking. In South Lanarkshire, we've used that legislation on three occasions to prohibit footway parking where that matter has been brought to our attention and where other means of stopping the footway parking weren't feasible. The first thing that we would normally have a look at is putting down standard waiting restrictions which relate to the road and the footway. But in some residential areas, that's not necessarily appropriate. We then look at putting bollards down, but if the footways are too narrow, by putting the bollards down in the road, that can cause problems. So we go through these steps, and as I say, on a number of occasions, we've actually used a traffic regulation order to prohibit footway parking. So the existing regulations or powers are there for local authorities to do that if they wish. In terms of the Roads Scotland Act, section 1292 says that a person who without lawful authority or reasonable excuse places or deposits anything on the road. So that the road includes the footway. So if somebody places a car on the road, on a footway, as to obstruct the passage or endanger road users, they commit an offence. So my reading of that would be that they don't need to see a vehicle getting driven on or know who necessarily drove the vehicle onto the footway, just the depositing of it causes problems.
What's your response to that, Superintendent?
It's kind of legal interpretations, which, you know, of course, you know, kind of, I said, if the Justice of the Peace would make a consideration of, I mean, I know it says any person, but you would still have to, you know, try and find out who that person was, you know, through. I mean, it's section 172 of the Road Traffic Act. Gives the police the legal means to require, you know, the registered keeper of the car or anybody who has information to state, you know, who was driving it at a particular time. But that can't be used for every piece of legislation. I would have to check up to see whether, you know, for what's just been quoted, whether we could legally or not make a requirement of a driver under those terms to state who was driving it. It's quite complex and it is down to different interpretations which may or may not be upheld at court.
In terms of the legislation that Mr. Gibson has just mentioned, have you any indication of how many folks have been done for that offence?
I've been in the police for 28 and a half years. I'm not aware of that ever having been used for somebody who is parked on a footpath.
Could we maybe get that figures from you as well?
I'll try, yes.
Thank you very much. Mr. Armitage or Mr. Hannah, do you want to come in about existing legislation? Mr. Armitage.
I would just comment that there is existing legislation in Scotland under Section 19 of the Road Traffic Act, which does make it an offence to park a heavy commercial vehicle on a footway, but I'm not really aware of that making that much difference, and I'm not quite sure how much difference a new, yet another offence being introduced would make.
Mr. Hanna, please.
I was just going to say, Convener, that wherein decriminalised parking and some of the changes in terms of the regulations and legislation, I feel sometimes is pushing council officers and police officers a bit apart. I think there's an opportunity, and it's been mentioned, where we do need to work closer together. In Fife, we work very closely with some of the local community police to deal with some of these issues. Quite often there are local problems caused by local people that need local solutions. We use that liaison and opportunity to do that. We use a range of traffic orders as well to introduce weight restrictions where that's appropriate. We introduce advisory H-bar markings to keep driveways clear and drop curb crossings clear, etc. But it's about working with people to find local solutions using the existing legislation that we have available.
But what it sounds like to me is a little bit of a hodgepodge here, because you've mentioned all of these different bits and pieces of legislation. Obviously, South Lanarkshire seems to be doing something different with traffic orders. But, you know, with all of that, we seem to have some confusion. We don't seem to have many, if any, offences actually being recorded. Does this draft bill help simplify matters in some regards in terms of dealing with some of these problems which folk are facing on a day and daily basis? Superintendent.
Yes, I think, you know, certainly from Police Scotland's perspective, you know, kind of we feel that it provides, you know, some much needed clarity to the situation. I mean, I think, as I've heard other people, other witnesses say today, I mean, roads and footways are a shared road space, but kind of quite often, you know, with regards, especially with regards to cab drivers that seem to think that, you know, their need takes, you know, precedence over everyone else's, and of course it doesn't. And there are, I mean, there are pieces of legislation currently in existence. I mean, not, I mean, the one that's just been spoken about, you know, depositing things on a road, and of course a footway is, you know, is classified as a road, is really kind of meant to be, you know, kind of loads such as building materials or items rather than specific vehicles. I mean, that would be my interpretation of it. So this, you know, this specific bill provides that clarity. You know, from our perspective, it's quite well written. It would provide also, you know, the ability for the police to use, you know, discretion as well. I mean, that's not going to get taken away. And I don't for a minute think if the bill, you know, is enacted, that, you know, the next day, you know, in the areas which are with the parkings not being decriminalised, I mean, I don't for a minute think the police will be out kind of issuing, you know, lots of tickets. It will be kind of used for specific community concerns, which have been spoken about already. It will be used during campaigns. And again, education, engineering and enforcement, I mean, it is very much, you know, in that order when it comes to kind of to police enforcement.
Any of the other gentlemen want to come in there about the simplification issue, Mr. Armitage?
I think at least in respect to heavy commercial vehicles, it would complicate the issue because you would have two pieces of legislation, both covering the same thing with different sets of exemptions, which would, I think, make the situation more complex rather than simpler.
Superintendent, would you like to respond to that?
I'm not aware of what the complications would be.
Mr. Armitage, would you like to explain the complications, please?
Well, you could have a situation where a vehicle was parked in accordance with Section 19 of the Road Traffic Act, in accordance with one of the exemptions for loading or unloading a heavy goods vehicle on the footway, but they could then be committing an offence under another act that covered exactly the same area. And I think that would be difficult for people to understand if there were two acts covering exactly the same thing with different exemptions.
Superintendent?
I would have to go away and kind of look into that, sorry.
Okay. Mr. Gibson, were you indicating there? Okay. John Wilson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Just to go back to one of the answers Mr. Gibson gave, you indicated that in South Lanarkshire you have prosecuted or fined three drivers, is that correct?
We've introduced three traffic regulation orders covering three different sections of footways in three different areas.
So have you prosecuted anybody under these regulations or fined anybody under those?
No, the regulations have worked. There are no contraventions.
There's no contraventions. So you just introduced three regulations and that stopped all the breaches that you felt were taking place in relation to... Right, it might be useful to let us know what these three regulations are so we could actually then speak to the proposer of the bill, because if it's resolved in South Lanarkshire, then it might help resolve it in other areas in Scotland. In relation to Mr. Superintendent Candlish's response, when the convener asked about taking someone or trying to take someone who has breached road traffic regulations and parked on the pavement, you indicated that the police would then have to, you know, secure the name of the driver, the owner of the vehicle, who was driving the vehicle at the time, a witness to say who was driving the vehicle at the time. Then you need to submit a report to the Procurator Fiscal's office to actually then, for the Procurator Fiscal then to take action against the individual if it was identified there was a breach. That seems very complicated, and I think you were alluding that it was a very complicated process to go through where that breach was implied. Is there no way that fixed penalty fines being imposed by the police or other traffic enforcement officers, local authority traffic enforcement officers, would actually resolve some of those issues that you've identified.
Superintendent.
Thank you. That, I mean, the fence is, I mean, it's to drive, you know, it's not to patch to drive, so we'd, I mean, it would only be the police that would have the power. I mean, as per the current legislation, I mean, a local authority, I mean, somebody who doesn't have, you know, the powers that a police officer has to require a driver or a registered keeper to state and who was using the vehicle at that time, it's only something that a police officer could, so it's only a requirement a police officer could make on another person. And ultimately, the offence wouldn't be to park, it would be to drive. So again, we would have to identify who the driver was, and you quite rightly say there would have to be, you know, a kind of secondary piece of evidence to back that up.
It's just the issue for me is, mm-hmm. clearly, if the owner of the vehicle commits an offence to be committed, then surely the owner of the vehicle has to take some responsibility for that offence being committed. If parking on a pavement is an offence, then the owner of that vehicle has some liability, surely, in relation to allowing that to happen. Because the defence for everybody, based on what you're saying, even if we introduce this legislation, could be that, well, sorry, I wasn't driving the vehicle, it was somebody else that was driving the vehicle, I'm not prepared to tell you who was driving the vehicle, and therefore no action can be taken because you don't know, there's no witness to say who was driving the vehicle at the time the offence was caused. So how do we change the legislation to ensure that those individuals who are breaching this new legislation can be dealt with in an appropriate manner?
Yeah, as per the current legislation, it would only be the driver of the vehicle who would be charged with driving on a footway. Okay, there are, if there was a certain circumstances, the owner or the registered keeper could be charged with aiding and abetting the offence, but there would have to be evidence to prove that. Now, that's under the current legislation. Under this new Act, my reading of it is it would be a fixed penalty offence, which would be almost like a parking ticket on the windscreen. So again, the penalty would be levied against the owner or registered keeper of the car, which again is a far, you know, quicker, a sharper and shorter means in which to enforce and perhaps, you know, deal with high levels of instances of offences being committed.
One of my earlier questions to the earlier panel was about the consistency of enforcement. Not only in local authority areas, we've got 32 local authorities, but we've also got the consistency of enforcement or potential enforcement by Police Scotland as well. And I was just speaking to my colleague next to me during the short break we had, is the issue of consistency between, say, for example, I live in central Scotland, and how someone parking on a pavement in Motherwell is dealt with compared to someone parking on a pavement in Hamilton. And clearly we've heard from Mr. Gibson, in South Lanarkshire, they have brought in new regulations which basically has dealt with on-pavement parking. But in Motherwell, a driver may find that there's no action taken against them for committing effectively the same offence in Motherwell as compared to Hamilton. How do we ensure we get consistency if this legislation is introduced throughout Scotland, that when a driver goes to any town or any village in Scotland, they know they potentially will be dealt with in the same way as they would be dealt with in other areas?
I think that would be challenging. I mean, within the non-decriminalised areas where the police would enforce this, I mean, I think what you've just said would be challenging because, the guidance to police officers, and obviously we would create our own kind of internal procedures and processes, but the general guidance would be using discretion where possible. But if there is a community concern, or if there is a kind of real emerging issue, then it would be focused upon. I mean, I don't, as kind of said earlier, I mean, I don't suggest for a minute that, you know, in every areas of Scotland, you know, the police would be issued parking tickets with regards to this new offence. I don't think that would happen. I think it would be used for, you know, specific areas and specific, concerns. But that you're right, and that would probably be quite challenging to create consistency. I don't think a consistent enforcement policy could be created other than, you know, it would be used as a tool which is proportionate to the circumstances in that area, and it would have to be backed up by a good education strategy as well.
Mr. Armitage, any comments?
Armitage.
I think one difficulty that the committee has in these questions, in finding answers to these questions about effectiveness and enforcement, is that we don't have any evidence in front of us from the former Greater London Council area where there has been legislation along these lines, as has been said, since 1974, as to how effective that is and whether it makes enforcement any easier. And unfortunately, none of us here can offer any evidence on that. But it would be something that I think would be helpful to the committee in deciding on this, if there were some sort of study available on whether things were actually any different in the former Greater London Council area to surrounding areas that don't have that legislation, whether there is any effective difference. And perhaps it would have been a good thing for the promoters of the bill to seek out such evidence. I did look and see if I could find any studies on that, but I was unable to...
I speak for the member in charge of the bill, sorry. But we will have the ability to question the member in charge of the bill next week. So we'll possibly ascertain then what the knowledge is about Greater London and various other places. But the committee, of course, itself will be looking at all aspects and will probably guide the clerks to find the information about any studies that have taken place. Not that I'm preempting what the committee may or may not decide, of course. Mr. Gibson.
Should the bill be enacted, I consider that given the current mix of decriminalised and non-decriminalised authorities within Scotland, there will be quite a considerable inconsistency in terms of enforcement. It's very noticeable at the moment in relation to the two councils Mr. Wilson mentioned, North Lanarkshire and South Lanarkshire, one where there is enforcement and one where there isn't. That's one part to it. The other part to it is in relation to the response that the decriminalised authorities can give. Most of them are small authorities other than the three or four larger cities who only carry out enforcement between 8, for example, within South Lanarkshire, it's 8 o'clock in the morning until 6 o'clock in the evening. We don't have any enforcement out with these times. So the police have obviously got 24/7 enforcement. So most of the issues and problems I can see happening in residential areas where people will be complaining about footway parking in the evening, we as an authority, given our current setup, wouldn't be able to deal with that, but the police would, so that there's a possibility for inconsistencies there.
Mr. Hannah, do you want to come in at this point?
I agree with those sentiments. In Fife, we've got 20 parking attendants, and certainly a number of the issues that maybe come around in relation to all of this will possibly be in some of the residential streets. And there won't be herds of parking attendants available to wander around these streets on a regular basis to observe these issues as they happen real time. The effect will be that it will have to be built into beats. It may be several days before parking patrols can actually look at these areas, and it will skew resources away from some of the busier town centre areas where some of the bigger issues happen in terms of congestion and parking.
On that particular issue of decriminalised, criminalised, the use of parking, wardens, attendants, whatever you call them in your various local authorities. And Mr. Hannah, you've just highlighted some of the things that they currently do. But from my own experience in terms of difficulties, the city wardens in Aberdeen were often used for, shall we call them, sting operations to deal with a particular problem. And after that happened a few times, the problem disappeared. Is that not the kind of thing that you could envisage happening? Mr. Hannah?
Absolutely. Some of the solutions I talked about earlier on were local solutions for local issues. One of the things we've been doing in Fife, and working very closely with Police Scotland and Fife Division, is initiatives like Park Safe and Curb Safe, where we target certain areas, and particularly around school frontages, and we've been doing a lot of that work over the last year or two. And that's exactly what you're talking about. It's actually bringing together council officer, parking attendants, local community police and others in concerted efforts to do a focused encouragement and awareness raising exercise backed up with enforcement where that's required. And I think that type of approach can sometimes produce good results.
This bill was in place. That's the kind of thing you could envisage happening in areas where there were difficulties.
I would say without any doubt that if this bill achieved royal assent, there would be that much better clarity in terms of enforcement that the inspector was talking about, superintendent was talking about, and it certainly would be a good tool in terms of providing teeth to those interventions.
Thank you. Mr. Gibson, before we move on to anything else, I want to go back to the three traffic orders that South Lanarkshire have put in place. I'd be interested to know the reasons for these traffic orders, how big an area these traffic orders cover, how difficult it was to get these traffic orders in place, because from my own past experience, it often took half a lifetime to get a traffic order in place, it always seemed like. Mm-hmm. Could you give us an idea of what all of that's about, please?
Yep, they're relatively short areas, very small areas where there were particular problems. I do have before and after photographs here, if you.
Where we can have a look at those, please.
Yep.
If you just want to continue, Mr. Gibson.
The traffic regulation orders were promoted under Section 1 of the Road Traffic Regulation Act 1984 in the normal fashion, using the procedures regulations, which we use for all traffic regulation orders, and took the usual 6 to 9 months to from start to finish.
6 to 9 months?
Yeah, between 6 and 9 months. Yeah.
Between 6 and 9 months. The area that is shown in the photographs is a very, very small area indeed, a tiny little cul-de-sac. Are the all three of the orders in areas that small?
Relatively so, yes.
So there were obviously particular difficulties in these areas which were easily resolved?
It was the best way of resolving these particular issues, because we wanted to allow people to continue to park on the road, but not in the footway. So we prohibited parking on one side of the road and allowed parking on the other side of the road rather than in the footways at both sides of the road. Because it was a particular issue, you can see the density of the housing in that area.
Would it be difficult to implement a road traffic order on a larger stretch of road where there may be these kind of difficulties?
From a technical point of view, there is absolutely no difference at all in promoting a traffic regulation order over a wider area.
From a practical point of view?
A practical point of view, it would only be the length of time to put together the actual order itself. However, during the promotion of the order, the members of the public do have the right to make comment or objection, and the wider the area is, the more likely we are to get some forms of adverse comments or objections which we would have to deal with.
In that tiny little area, how much do you think it costs to promote the order there, including the signage and all of the rest of it?
Probably about £1,500.
£1,500 for that tiny area?
Yeah.
And if you were going to do a large stretch, that would be much, much more?
Yes.
So this draft bill as it is would possibly save you a lot of money rather than having to do a hodgepodge of various orders?
Yes, it would. But the reverse of that is in places where we do want to be able to permit people to be able to park on footways, due to the density of housing, we need to go through the same process, and it's likely to be larger areas, and therefore the cost will still be there.
Okay, but so the draft bill as is would allow you some flexibility in terms of whether or not to enforce in certain areas, recognising local difficulties.
I didn't see anything in the bill which gave us leeway in terms of enforcement. The regulation, from my reading of the bill, covered all footways unless we promote an order to say otherwise. If the regulation's in place, then we would require to enforce it.
You could pass one ginormous order, basically, exempting all of the areas that you wanted to exempt.
My understanding is not. We've to... Yes, in terms of one order, but it would be lots of different streets, so it would be
yeah,
in that
but one, yes, or,
yeah,
one order.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, okay. Anyone else want to come in on that point? Mr. Hannah?
Yeah. This issue is where I was referring earlier on to the challenges of retrofitting this into existing streets, and listening to some of the comments that were made earlier. Looking at the background work to the bill, some of the costings that were done are very rough, but there was figures there talking about potentially something like 10 exempt areas in Scotland, costing something like £500,000. In Fife, I believe, I've not got any figures because none of this work's been done, of course, but I would believe we'd be involved in potentially dozens of exempt areas across various locations in Fife. The nature of the settlements we have, not just in Fife, but in many places.
There, in terms of that exemption, exactly the same question I posed to Mr. Gibson. You could create one super order, if you like, exempting all of the places that you thought in Fife should be exempted.
Potentially, I would say we could promote one order, but yeah. The point that I'm making here is, as we were talking about, is not the technicalities and the legal issues about technically making the order. It's about the background work that would have to be done before you get to the point that you have an order and a schedule to make. And what I'm saying is that in Fife, I reckon we're going to end up with a significant number of exempt areas. The reason for that is that many of the streets and many of our small towns and villages are designed for horse and wagon in many cases. We've got all of the coastal villages around the East Newt. We've got many of the small and mining villages in the south of Fife. The point that was made earlier on is that the way that we live our lives today and the amount of car ownership we have in many families in these areas, I'm envisaging that what we will do potentially do with this bill is we'll swap one problem for another bigger problem. And we will end up then having to manage displaced parking issues and chasing the problem around various different streets. And that was really just the point I was trying to make in terms of the size of exempt areas.
But by the sounds of it, from your knowledge here today, you already have a fair indication of what areas you would exempt, which may be an entire village in the East Newca Fife, because you know already that it's never going to work to the degree that it should because of the horse and cart scenario. So you've already got that knowledge, have you not?
I have local knowledge, and I'm confident in that knowledge that there will be a number of locations, potentially small villages, whole villages, maybe perhaps smaller towns, where those exemptions may have to cover those larger areas.
Okay. I asked the previous panel about A and B roads and private roads, because as it stands at the moment, the draft bill seems to exclude them. What's your opinion on that? Mr. Hannah?
I'm quite content with the proposal in the bill where it will address all restricted streets. I don't think there's any need for this bill to address unrestricted roads, whether they're A and B class roads in the rural environment or not.
Any other comments on that, Mr. Armitage?
I think that the reference to restricted roads does actually give issues, because it's very difficult for anybody to know what is a restricted road and what isn't a restricted road, unless they're very familiar with road traffic legislation and have copies of individual orders. The restricted roads by default are C-class and unclassified roads with street lighting. It is possible for orders to be passed making A and B class roads in urban areas restricted roads, but that's not the way that the Scottish Government advises councils to do that. The current advice, which I've got in front of me, says that all mandatory speed limits other than those on restricted roads should be made by order under Section 84 of the Road Traffic Regulation Act. This includes the making of a 30-mile-an-hour speed limit on a Class A or B road in Scotland and any Class C or unclassified road which is unlit. So if somebody's following current Scottish Government advice, then A and B class roads will not be restricted roads in the meaning of the term in the Road Traffic Regulation Act. So I think that, but some of them might be, so, and you can't tell by looking at the signs. You can tell whether a road has a 30-mile-an-hour speed limit or not easily, but you can't tell whether it's a restricted road or not. So for the public to understand it, I think the legislation would probably have to be changed. So
what you're basically saying, Mr. Armitage, in layman's terms, is that you think that A and B roads and private roads should be included in the bill?
What I'm saying is that at the moment, most but not all A and B roads would be excluded as it's currently drafted, and all private roads would be excluded.
It would be easier to deal with if all A and B roads and other roads were included in the bill.
I think there may be other ways of phrasing the legislation, which could be by reference to the speed limit, which might be easier to understand.
Mr. Gibson, please.
Yes, Mr. Stuart. All roads should be included if this legislation goes ahead, including private roads, because a private road is just a road that's maintained by somebody else. It's still a road in the terms of the
public
side.
That's the kind of plain and simple answer I like, yeah. Mr. Gibson. Mr. Wilson.
Just for clarification, Mr. Gibson, you said including private roads?
Yes.
My understanding is there are certain issues regarding enforcement in private roads.
No.
There's no issues?
No.
So that's a no then, Mr. Wilson.
So that's quite clear, you're quite definite. If it was a private road, then the police or traffic
enforcement... I think, Wilson, both Mr. Gibson and Mr. Armitage gave a resounding no there.
It'd be interesting to hear from the superintendent, convener.
I think I'd defer to the experts in that.
Thank you, Superintendent. Jane Baxter, please.
Thanks, convener. This question might have been answered already, but is an unadopted road the same as a private road? Yeah.
Mr. Gibson, yeah, we've got agreement
there.
Thank
you, thanks.
Yeah. Anything else, Jane?
No, that was just a point of clarification,
okay.
Thank you.
Gentlemen, what do you think would be the main barriers in terms of enforcing this bill? You've touched upon criminalised and decriminalised areas. You've touched upon... traffic wardens, city wardens, or parking attendants, whatever you use in your particular area. What are the other impediments? Mr. Gibson.
The main problem is going to be in areas of very dense housing where there is insufficient parking to be able to accommodate all of the vehicles. The local authorities will get pressure put on them, one, to enforce the regulations, and then secondly, once we do start to enforce it, to provide additional off-street parking in residential areas, which is not the remit of the local authority, and the local authorities don't have budgets for providing residential parking. So that will be a major issue, I think.
Okay. Mr. Armitage?
Well, my authority doesn't have decriminalised parking, so because we're a rural authority, so we couldn't actually carry out enforcement. If we did have decriminalised parking, I could see difficulties because we wouldn't have the resources to appoint additional staff at the moment, and actually sending people round a large rural area would be quite difficult. But in our case, it would fall on the police.
Are rural authorities that do have decriminalised parking, or authorities with large rural areas, like Fife, for example, that have decriminalised? Yeah?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. In terms of sending folk around Aberdeenshire, it seems to me that the council sends other folk right round Aberdeenshire to do other things. So what makes this so difficult?
I don't think we'd be in a position to respond to something, if we had a report. What we do with our existing parking attendants who work on the council car parks is that they would go to a particular area, but they wouldn't be in a position to respond to reports from a diffuse rural area and to dot around the place.
Mr. Hannah, please.
As I said earlier on, realistically what would happen, particularly with decriminalised parking, and what would happen in Fife is that if there were any issues in outwith town centre, residential, rural areas, whether they were near the town centre or whether they were out in the sticks, we would arrange for parking attendants to patrol those areas or to respond to any concerns, but it wouldn't be an instant real-time issue. It would need to be planned into planned action in terms of expanding beats or whatever. So the expectations might not match the reality of what would happen and the timescales it would happen. And I also fear one of the potential issues is that we'll end up getting involved in a whole load of neighbour disputes, because in relation to parking in residential areas, quite often it's local issues caused by local people which require local solutions. And I sometimes think that what we could find happening here is that we're drawn into the middle of all these local neighbour disputes that then say the legislation's there, why aren't you coming to sort this out? Someone needs to be here right now. And that's going to put a significant challenge on local authorities to deal with all the other priorities and having to deal with these local issues.
Some of these disputes probably already exist. That's mm-hmm. probably one of the reasons why you did your three orders, was it, Mr. Gibson? Yes. Okay. If I could turn to the financial memorandum, and the Finance Committee hasn't looked at that yet. Now, I'm well aware that you've all talked about resources, and after today's statement by the Chancellor of the Exchequer, I think we'll all be talking about resources or the lack of them for a fair while to come. And I'm also well aware of the amount of money that's often put against the raising of orders and various other things by roads officers, having been in a local authority for 13 years myself. And I know that, again, everybody around the table, and apart from Cameron, has had the same experiences. Realistically, do you want to give comment about the financial memorandum? Mr. Gibson?
It's very difficult to put some sort of cost on it, but we've recently went through a new piece of legislation, which was the Disabled Persons Parking Places Scotland Act 2009, which made sure that we had to put in some regulations. And within South Lanarkshire, we spent just over £600,000 on that piece of legislation to put in the necessary signing and lining of all the disabled persons' parking bays. One of the other things that's thrown up as well is that we've got to maintain that and keep it going. I can see within this legislation, while we've got an initial financial outlay, capital outlay, that the council will need to find in order to bring it in, it will continue to require updated on a very regular basis as things change in various areas. As car ownership increases, as it has been recently, there's a possibility of this just spiralling year after year.
Mr. Hannah.
In terms of DPPP, which has been mentioned, Chair, so I'll just take the opportunity to talk on that very briefly. Yes, we introduced a substantial number of enforceable bays as a result of that legislation. I don't have an exact figure, and it's hard to say, but I know that we're probably talking around about £500,000 we've spent in putting the infrastructure.
Talking about something completely and utterly different from the proposals that are in this draft bill. The bill that was put forward by Jackie Bailey was pretty resource intensive, and I think that was pretty well known to begin with, was it not?
Where it is similar, what I'm talking about mainly is infrastructure costs in terms of signs and lines, etc., to make these bays enforceable, and that's where the significant part of the cost has come from.
What do you mean, enforceable bays?
The disabled persons parking.
No, sorry, you're going back to that. I'm talking about this bill.
Sorry. I thought you were talking about the DPPP. Yeah. In terms of this bill, where I see the biggest cost coming is, as I spoke about earlier on, is exempt areas. In Fife, I envisage a significant number of those. And to introduce an exempt area will require some heavy street engineering in terms of signing and lining. Apart from the cluttering issue that we'll get, that there will be an infrastructure cost attached to that if you're introducing town-wide exemption areas. And that's where the cost will come.
Why do you think that will require a huge amount of signing and lining?
Well, if you're going to introduce... Well, if you look at London, where London has areas that are exempt from this type of bill, they have to introduce signs to indicate that parking is permitted on a footway, etc. So we would similarly have to introduce additional signage to give effect to the TRO we would have to introduce to override the bill.
Sometimes I think we overly complicate things because I don't actually see the need for signing anyway, to be honest with you, but that's a personal opinion. We overdo the signs in almost every aspect of road traffic orders. Mr. Armitage.
I think to implement a road traffic order, you do actually need to have a level of signing and lining to make it clear. I would agree with comments previously made that in London, they do normally mark out parking bays partly on the footway, partly on the carriageway, and signs indicating that it's permitted, and I don't see any real alternative to that. You might be able to make a special area with signs going in and out of it, a special parking control area, but I'm not quite sure whether that would work. I would defer to colleagues with more experience of special parking control areas.
Mr. Gibson.
We would want to, if the bill came in, permit people to park partly on the footway, but only over certain sections or lengths of road within a residential area. For example, you wouldn't want them parking near a junction where it was going to block visibility, because at the moment, while people may well park in these areas, they're parking in these areas and to my mind, causing an obstruction. The local authority couldn't mark a parking bay in that area, so we need to start and stop it along each length of streets and delineate the beginning and the end of these parking areas. And the Traffic Signs Regulations and General Directions 2002 is the legislation which dictates what signing and lining is required, and there is a regulatory need to put in a sign at the start and the end of the regulation and every 60 metres therein.
Superintendent, do you have anything to say on the financial memorandum?
With regards to Police Scotland, obviously we deal with a myriad of issues each day to keep community safe in Scotland, and if this was introduced, it would be it would probably actually kind of give more clarity towards this particular issue, and perhaps it would be non-cashable savings almost, it would perhaps add that clarity and there wouldn't be any extra costs incurred by Police Scotland.
Thank you very much for your evidence today. I now close this meeting of the committee. Thank you.